Hello everybody, this is Chris Callahan with UVM Extension Ag Engineering. Welcome back to another video on post and wire support structures for SWD netting. In this video, we're going to be covering the layout of post locations, augering holes for wooden posts that are set in the ground, and driving anchors, both for the perimeter and for interior posts. So let's jump in. This is the site where we did the demonstration build that uses both wood posts and steel posts. This is the berry patch in Steventown, New York. It's about half an acre, 19-year-old blueberry bush planting, and it's about 80 feet in the narrow direction and 270 feet in the longer direction. This is a picture of it after we just put the panels of netting on, but it gives you a good sense of what the structure actually looks like once things are getting close to completion. Now keep in mind, this is a hybrid structure. We did this to demonstrate two different construction approaches. On the left-hand side, which is the south side of this planting, we used wooden posts, and those posts go into holes that are augered into the ground. On the northern section, it's built with steel posts, and those steel posts go on top of earth anchors shown there on the in the lower left corner, which have a flange on them. So the helical piece gets driven into the ground. These are 3 feet long. The flange sits on the ground and they have an eye on the top of them, almost like an eye screw. The post has a hole in the bottom of it. Post goes on top of this and a bolt goes through and that holds the posts in place. So two different approaches for getting our anchoring in place. One is setting wooden posts, the other is driving earth anchors. The earth anchors, again, are used under the steel posts. They're also used all along the perimeter. That's what we end up tying the cable to hold the whole thing down. So let's talk about laying out posts a little bit. This setup at the berry patch in Steventown was set up to demonstrate both wooden posts and steel posts. You'll remember it's 80 feet wide and 270 feet long. And at the time, the longest span we could come up with, based on consulting with Gentech Shade Technologies, the provider of the structural system, and in partnership with TechNet, the providers of the netting panels, the longest span we could come up with was 20 feet. I will say that in talking with both of those companies more recently, they can now do up to 36-foot spans. Part of the reason for doing this demonstration was to do a demonstration and understand how it worked and how it responded to events. And partly as a result of the work we've done, the companies are more ready to support a 36-foot span. So that's all to say that our setup was based on a 15 foot by 20 foot grid. You know, in more recent installations, the grid is getting larger. So in a recent one that we've been working on, it's up to 20 feet of span in the length direction, and 36 in the width. So that reduces the hardware quite a bit, and also makes the netting management a lot easier. You're dealing with fewer zippered seams, which are all along these cables right here. You're dealing with fewer of those zippered seams, and so both in first-time installation and also seasonal retraction and disbursement or deployment. So both first-time installation and seasonal retraction and deployment becomes a bit easier. You just have fewer seams to work with. So best to discuss your specific site and needs with the folks at Gentech Shade Technologies when laying out the system. A little inside view here. We pulled up some of the netting just so you can see what it looks like. This is looking from the southeast corner of the planting. So you have two rows of wooden posts that have been sunk in the ground. You can see the remnants of augering here. The post is in the ground. It's been backfilled after being set plumb. And in the far view of the photo, you can see steel posts. And these steel posts are sitting on top of the earth anchors that we just talked about that have flanges on top of them. The cables are strung up and over and all in one direction and then also perpendicular to that to make a nice grid that supports the netting. So making holes for these wooden posts, you can see the wooden posts we have over here. Making holes for these posts came down to trying a couple different methods. One was a one-person earth auger. You can see on the left-hand side, looks like it's designed for one person to auger a hole out. In the right kind of soil, that's exactly what happens. You have one person, it's easy, and you're done. We found we actually needed to use the two-person auger for doing most of the holes, or use two people on a one-person auger. There was enough times where we ran into small stones that seemed really small, nothing larger than the size of our foot. But it was enough to sort of stop that auger dead in the tracks. So we ended up doing a fair bit of pry bar work. You can see Greg here digging up a stone out of a hole that we were in the middle of augering. So the augers do a nice job of the bulk of the work. They do not eliminate the need for hand digging, at least in this soil. You can see some of the stones that came out of this hole. Generally speaking, so the one over by the postal digger here was one we had to take out manually. The earth auger did not take that out. So know your soil before getting started here and come up with a plan for those pesky ones that are gonna, the pesky stones that are gonna get in your way. Again, returning back to our plan here, the wooden posts go into these augered holes and then get set plumb with a level and backfilled to keep them straight. And you check them in two directions for plumb. The next step that we took on was setting earth anchors, and that's these things, these black painted steel earth anchors, and they have a helical portion on the bottom, sort of screws it into the ground, and that has an eye on top for attaching things to and for driving it. So we again, in relatively easy soil, that'd be pretty sandy soil or soil without any stones, you can do that by hand using a piece of rebar. It is a bit of a workout, but it does get the job done. We ended up making up an adapter to go over the output shaft of an earth auger that attaches on one side to that output shaft, and on the other side it goes over the eye of the earth anchor. This is just a quick view of that. So again, it goes over. You can see the hex shaft coming off of this. Is a Groundhog earth auger. It's a toe behind that we ended up using, which I'll explain in a minute. Has a hex shaft, which is 1 3/8 from flat to flat. And so we made this to be dimensioned to fit over that 1 3/8 flat to flat. And then it's a bit longer in the other direction because you're going peak to peak. Plans are available online, and I'll also show them toward the end of the presentation. On the other side, it's sized to go over the eye of the earth anchor. Okay, so these two pieces are welded together. You have one that goes over the hex, one that goes over the eye. They are now ready to do business. Here's that adapter attached to the Groundhog earth auger. We ended up using this Groundhog earth auger for a couple of reasons. In our first experiences using the one and two person earth augers, we just found them to be a little unstable. And you know, you're going along and you run into a rock and the thing really shifts on you, and it just felt like it was making for a potential set of broken ribs or something else. And so this is another option where it's a tow behind. You actually tow this behind your car, and then it transforms into this. The tow hitch comes off or folds back, and then it turns into this, which is now something you can move around kind of like a wheelbarrow. it's really stable, meant for one person operation. Again, we use two people for most of our work just to be on the safe side. You can see the output shaft here. You can put an extension on it. It comes, generally they come with, I think it's a 2-foot extension. For the work we were doing, we had some 4-foot anchors. So this was just about right without the extension. Gives you the room to get the anchor just sort of tapped in the ground, put the adapter on it, and get it started. You end up driving it all the way to the ground. So it is a bit of a, you know, you're going to be bending a bit to get the job done. But worked really well, and the adapter really worked out. It is smart to have some sort of locking hole. So the output shaft has a hole for a pin, a locking pin. So putting a hole in this adapter, probably something larger than what we ended up here with. We just did what we could on the fly and put a little bit of wire through it. But something better than that would be great. But something to lock it in place. This is a still from a video showing how the Groundhog goes, the adapter goes over the earth anchor eye. And even if you don't have that flange, the eye sort of bottoms out right up here at the top of that adapter. So it's a loose fit, but it's enough. It's enough to, again, we're pushing down and we're trying to spin the thing. So it doesn't need to really be super tight on that. This is a shot of an earth anchor actually driven. Here are a series of clips that'll show you a couple different times we drove anchors. This is one that went super well on the first try. You can see it going all the way to the bottom. This one was one that went pretty well. You can see us adjusting it to be vertical as much as possible. And doesn't quite go all the way down, but in this case, it's going to be close enough. And we called it. And on the next one, this is a case of where we run into something, and you can get a sense after we're doing this a while that the anchors start to tell you where they want to go a little bit to avoid. See how this is spinning a little bit toward me and to my right? Just follow it, and it'll clear the rock and keep going. And here's one where we actually had to go in both forward direction and reverse to get it to drive. You'll see this in a second. It's forward. We're going to run into something. And Greg reverses it. Forward, reverse, forward, and it goes. This is showing how the adapter goes over the hex shaft. You can see that on this, on the side closest to us, it's flat, and it's flat on the far side, but notice that it's peak to peak going the other direction, so it's a little bit longer. So just need to take that into account when you're making up your adapter. These Groundhog Earth augers are available at most rental companies. This one was not far away from us and made a world of difference. Here's a better shot of the adapter that we had made up. Again, showing this is a better view of the 1 3/8 hex drive shaft inside the adapter. And so it's 1 3/8 in one direction, and it turns out to be about 1 5/8 in the other direction. Making this a hair larger than you need will make it easier to put the thing on the hex shaft and take it off. Don't go too much larger than what's noted here, or you'll have too loose a fit and might start to deform the drive. We found the overall length about 3 inches of on the shaft side and 3.5 inches on the eyelet side on the earth anchor side was just about right. There's a quarter to a 3/8 inch hole drilled through the adapter for that locking pin. Again, size it to what you need. It's really just to hold the adapter on the shaft. It doesn't really see any shear force at all. And then here are the dimensions of the anchor loop side. We found it was about 1 1/16 by 2 3/4 inches. All this is made of quarter inch tube stock. This end was made of tube stock. This end was made of two angles, because we didn't have that tube stock available, but it is a fairly standard size, so you might be able to get it. This is showing some of the finished results. These are the perimeter anchors along the north side of the planting close to the raspberry tunnel. You can see it. You end up with a bit of a variable job depending on your soil. This one did not. This is as deep as we could drive this one, whereas this one is almost all the way down to the eye. This one, again, not quite all the way. You know, you run into some challenges in driving these anchors, and sometimes you need to accept good enough, and just you don't want to overwork it. The more you work the soil, the less uplift protection you have. Anytime you're disturbing the soil, you're reducing the ability for these earth anchors to do their job, which is really protecting. It's first of all supporting the tension that's needed in the cables to support the netting, and in the case of a heavy wind, it's to provide some uplift protection. So we don't want to go back and forth a lot. We don't want to try drilling one in and then find we have a problem and try to move just a couple inches over. It becomes a bit of a balancing act. You know, if you have to move, you want to move more than 3 or 4 inches away so that you're getting into some new soil. Here's a picture of a perimeter anchor. Remember, perimeter anchors don't have the flanges because there's no steel posts going on them. They just end up with cable going through them. As a perimeter anchor being set, and ended up at a bit of an angle because we had to avoid a stone. But the it's just fine the way it is. You can see the flanged earth anchor here. This is for an interior post, and you can see that the flange, you want to get that as close to the ground as possible, and even some of them sort of came right up against the ground. The perimeter earth anchors are 4 feet long, and the interior earth anchors are 3 feet long. So they take a little bit different amounts of work as a result. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of background on laying out post locations, augering holes, and driving anchors for these post and wire support structures for SWD exclusion netting. In our next video, we'll talk about setting posts and getting ready to run wire.